Dragon Ball Super has had a lot of publicity in the past few months, with the release of their new movie as well as the conclusion of the Granolah Arc presenting us with a totally new transformation for the evil Emperor Frieza. People have been dying for new content, and finally, after a 4-month hiatus, we got just that. Taking place just prior to the superhero movie, we get to see things that led straight up into that movie. So this arc really serves as a prequel of sorts to the film. We get to see how Dr. Hedo started out, as well as getting to see Mai returned back to her older appearance. There were also plenty of Easter eggs for fans of Dragon Ball who have been blessed with the chance to view GT, and due to this, I do wonder about the canonicity of GT to Dragon Ball Super, and if it's possible that we've been wrong to separate them the entire time. Welcome to the Amagi. Before we begin, we publish a new video every day, so be sure to subscribe to our channel and ring the bell to be notified about our latest videos. The Amagi's reach stretches beyond just this channel, so if you're a fan of us, please consider subscribing to our other channels and following us on all of our social media. Help us reach our goal of passing 100,000 followers on all of our accounts by the end of the year. Also, be sure to see if you're still subscribed. YouTube lately has been unsubscribing people for whatever reason, and we just want to make sure you don't miss out on any more of our videos. Also, we now have Amagi merch, so if you want to show your support for the channel, as well as show all of your friends how much you love anime, make sure to check out our merch store. We've got t-shirts, long sleeves, hoodies, and more, all with great Amagi designs on them. And with that, let's get on with the video. The chapter begins by detailing what Goku and Vegeta are doing. We come to learn that after the events of the Granolah Arc, that Goku and Vegeta begin to feel insecure about the vast chasm that separates their power from Frieza's. To that end, they return to Beerus's planet where they train their pants off. We get to witness Goku, Beerus, Whis, and the Seer Fish enjoying some delicious yakisoba. Vegeta, on the other hand, is busy worrying about Frieza and isn't eating at all. And for the first time in glorious full color, we get to see the true appearance of Black Frieza's new form. And frankly, it looks exactly as many of us believed it would. It's hinted to us that the training that Goku and Vegeta have been doing is solely for their next encounter with Frieza. But one person was missing from this scene, and that was Broly, which leads me to believe that Broly is looking to join the main cast of the series in the upcoming chapters of the manga. So that is something to look forward to. The chapter then shifts to a jewelry store in Mosquito Town of West City that is being robbed by a couple of thugs. Everyone is awestruck at the appearance of Great Saiyaman X1 and X2, in actuality, Goten and Trunks. They appear using cheesy one-liners and keeping with the theme of cleaning as they fight, utterly beating the thugs into submission. After the situation is brought under control by the police, Goten and Trunks leave the scene and regroup on a building where they could talk about what they're doing. As it turns out, the boys who tend to blow hot and cold on Gohan's style during the course of his time as Great Saiyaman are now imitating him, but not because they think he's cool, because let's face it, he hasn't been cool since the Cell Saga, but instead because they've come to enjoy a new video game called Clean God and are hyped up for a live-action adaptation of the movie, which both of the boys so desperately want to see. Goten then receives a notification on his smartphone of another crime being committed, but to their dismay, it's cybercrime. Someone stole a whole group of people's personal data. Trunks laments this because you can't beat up scumbags over the internet. Goten reveals that Trunks was never good with computer stuff, and so upon getting a call from an enraged Chi-Chi who was angry that Goten didn't come home when he said he would, Goten would hit the bricks. Changing out of his costume, to which he and Trunks agree, is quite the chore to do. Trunks says he might be able to call in a favor from Pilaf, and the two part ways. Trunks, not wanting to remove his gear, just plans to fly home in it and sneak in to change. However, he's stopped by his grandparents, both of whom are standing in the street with their pet Dino, looking for a bouquet of flowers to send Pan due to her attending the first day of kindergarten. Trunks quickly puts his helmet back on because he hasn't told his family what he's doing. Right as he puts it on, his grandparents see him and their pet dinosaur rushes over to him to show him love and affection. Dr. Briefs mentions that it's strange that the dino is showing him so much love considering that he isn't family. Trunks would tell him that this is because superheroes are friends to one and all, great and small. He then commands the dino to sit and it obeys him. He then bids them farewell and flies off, leaving Dr. Briefs to speculate about the familiarity of his voice. It's then that they continue trying to find the perfect gift for Pan, and they hear a commotion down the road. They turn around to see Capsule Corporation helper robots running down the road, much to the confusion of Dr. Briefs. He asks what's going on. He and his wife Bikini turn around, and to their horror, a freaking zombie is standing there. This leads to a massive recall of helper robots, an event which leads to the Pilaf gang, now the heads of the research and development department, to possessing a packed schedule. However, despite that, they still have time for a special request from Trunks. Pilaf finishes a transformation watch just like Gohan used back in the day. He finishes one for Trunks and states that Goten's will be finished the day after, and that through this, they're square. It's revealed that Pilaf is the only one who knows what Goten and Trunks are up to, and he's keeping their secret because Trunks is keeping Pilaf's secret. As it turns out, sometime in the past, Pilaf was caught by Trunks stealing the Dragon Balls from Bulma's room. To keep Trunks quiet, he promised him a favor, and this was Trunks calling it in. Bulma walks in and asks what they're conspiring about, and they both deflect the question. She asks Trunks why he isn't in school, and he says that he'll be on his way. But before he can go, he goes out of his way to help Mai, who is struggling to carry a rather large box. He carries it for her and plans to ask her something privately, but Shu keeps interrupting, so he tells her he will tell her later when he gets off from school. He then makes his way to school, having changed into his uniform, getting on his bike, and pedaling faster than most cars can drive. He's then offered a hot dog by a kind food truck driver, which he accepts without stopping, tossing a coin to him in return. He also witnesses two punks tossing a can out that nearly hits a poor widow baby in the head. He rushes forward before it can and flicks the can back into the back of the punk's head. The punk asks who did that as Trunks completely passes him like a freaking bullet. He makes it to school where he chains off his bike and proceeds to quickly hop up the stairs. By this time, school has already begun and he's locked out, so he needs to crawl in through the window, which he thinks he's doing quietly. To his horror though, the teacher is standing above him. The teacher begins to reprimand him for his constant tardiness and threatens him, telling him that if he continues to act like this, he could end up expelled. He then gives him a detention slip and allows Trunks to sit down at his desk as his schoolmate, Compass, begins to poke fun at him for his failure. Trunks states that he just doesn't have as much time as he should due to his duties. Compass asks what duties he means and Trunks doesn't tell him. The conversation then shifts to Trunks eventually taking over Capsule Corp from Bulma, something he doesn't look forward to. After class, Trunks is approached by another member of his friend circle, Rula, who mentions that she heard that Trunks is looking for adventure. She mentions the rumors swirling about the ghosts in town, and Compass states that the hockey team had a sighting. Trunks is a little disturbed about it. They ask if he wants to go with them to the abandoned mansion on Mount Butterfly and says to treat it like a dare. Trunks blows them off though, saying that he doesn't have time for a silly rumor. They say he never wants to hang out anymore, but in actuality, Trunks is deathly afraid of ghosts and zombies, which is ironic considering that Gotenks' signature move is Super Kamikaze Ghost Attack. Also might be a slight nod to the Fusion Reborn movie in which Goten and Trunks needed to fight zombies, including the entire German army of World War II. Also, I still can't get over the fact that Pan can't fly now. She was taking to air like a fish does to water when she was a toddler. What changed? Anyway, back to the chapter. Trunks grabs Goten as soon as school ends, and they both head back to Capsule Corp, where they proceed to play their favorite video game, Clean God. Trunks reveals to Goten that he got two tickets for the day one screening of the movie, which will also include a meet and greet with the star of the film. Goten is through the roof, as he had thought it would be impossible for them to get a hold of any. Trunks says that it was hard, but bursts Goten's bubble by saying that he could only get a hold of two and was actually planning to invite someone else. Goten takes it a lot better than you would think, though, and becomes sort of a killer wingman for Trunks. When it's revealed that the recall has busted Mai's schedule, meaning that she couldn't go even if she wanted to, Trunks cooks up a plan to free her weekend up. Not like she was interested though. She said the event wasn't really her thing. When asked if she can't take a single night off, Pilaf states that she can't, as Bulma busted them for stealing the Dragon Balls due to the presence of a security camera. And so, to forcefully free up her schedule, Trunks goes back and recruits Goten. Besides just going haywire, many helper bots were missing entirely. Goten and Trunks head to the neighborhood where most of the reports had come from. Trunks seems quite a bit on edge. Trunks states that even a residential street is scary at night, and Goten responds by reminding him that ghosts have been spotted there in recent days. Trunks scolds him for mentioning that, but retorts that it doesn't really matter because ghosts don't exist. He is a man of science, and ghosts aren't real. Goten then reminds him that both of their fathers died once and came back as ghosts, to which Trunks says was completely different. It's then that Trunks would look around and accidentally stumble into a Frankenstein-like creature. Looking up at it, he freaks out and makes a run for it, accidentally bumping into what is essentially his morpher on a lamppost, which will have complications later on in the chapter. Goten watches as the creature walks away. Suddenly, an uppity man with a helper robot would be walking down the road giving instructions to the robot. The creature would look back and would click a remote. Suddenly, the robot goes haywire and runs off, disobeying his master's command. Goten and Trunks surmise that this person is the culprit. When the zombie gets into a car and begins to drive away to a mansion on Mount Butterfly, they follow it through the air. When they get there, Trunks is still psyched out by the whole situation and is considering abandoning the mission. However, when Goten asks if Trunks still wants to go to his movie date with Mai, Trunks musters the courage. They go to the mansion and look in only to discover a secret sushi packing business that's being run by the zombies and the escaped helper robots. Suddenly, they believe that they were seen. However, it turns out that Trunks' friends who had dared him to go to the mansion were also there inside the building and were captured. Since Trunks was the only one who had the transformation watch, it was up to him to save them. He tries to transform into Great Saiyaman X1, but his watch isn't working. He continues to try, surmising that it had happened when he bumped it. In the end, it finally activates. Trunks rushes in to rescue his friends, nearly introducing himself until one of his friends turns out to be Saiyaman X1's greatest fan. Trunks does battle with the zombies, but suddenly his watch malfunctions and reveals his true identity. His friends are startled. Goten, thinking on his feet, blasts the breaker with his ki, turning out the lights. He then pulls Trunks' friends out, and as they all flee, they ask if what they saw could be real, and Goten convinces them that it was just an illusion by the ghosts. They somehow believe him and run away in terror. In the darkness, the only zombie left standing, a large linebacker named Alpha 12, asks where Trunks is. Trunks responds that even though Alpha 12 didn't know where Trunks was, it didn't mean Trunks didn't know where Alpha 12 was. Trunks then turns Super Saiyan, lighting up the room. He then shifts back into Great Saiyaman X1 and would manage to beat the zombie senseless. After this, he transforms back to base and turns on the lights as Goten joins, explaining that his friends are safe. Goten asks if he got to question them on what was going on, and Trunks chastises him for not thinking of that before knocking them out. Trunks shrugs it off though, assuming that they can just find a clue that is likely laying around somewhere. They step into a back room that appears to be a laboratory. Inside is a safe, and when opened, they find within it only a single optical disc. Taking it out, it says Dr. Gero upon it, but Trunks doesn't pick up on this. He says that it doesn't really matter because all that matters is that Mai is free and they can go to the movies together. They leave the mansion only to be stopped by Krillin, who had been called up by the police force to investigate a case of bodies being stolen from the morgue that were now supposedly walking around Mount Butterfly. Trunks is startled stiff by the knowledge that he was really fighting true zombies. Back at the lab, we see Dr. Hedo appear, confused at the destruction. He comes to the zombie named Alpha 12 and asks him what had happened. He states that Saiyaman X1 showed up and defeated them. Dr. Hedo simply cannot believe that his entire Alpha series was defeated by one person. He tells Alpha 12 to rest, reminding him that he's already a corpse and that Hedo will fix him up soon. He then goes into the back room and realizes that the optical disc left to him by his grandfather is gone. He mentions that it was irreplaceable, and Alpha 12 tells him that it was taken by the attackers before apparently succumbing to his injuries. Hedo then finds a patch from Trunks' jacket that says Blue Hal High School on it, leaving Hedo to question who could have done it before stating that he must now secure funding a different way. The following day, Trunks returns to the workshop to ask Mai if she's free to see the movie, only to be met with a panicking Pilaf squad, who are now working at their highest gear to repair robots. Trunks asks if she's free now, and she responds that their workload actually increased, as it was revealed that all of the missing robots were found at Mount Butterfly but had been destroyed, and that they would have to continue fixing the robots up, likely missing entire nights of sleep just to reach their quota. Trunks, unable to believe it, screams out in frustration, and that is where the chapter ends. This chapter was funny, and it was nice to see Goten and Trunks get a spotlight, though it seems to focus more on Trunks and less on Goten, which makes Goten feel like a side character. Little to no development was made to Goten's character, as he still remains the clueless yes-man to Trunks' false confidence. I also think that I'll never be able to get over the fact that Pan is self-conscious about being unable to fly. I simply can't understand that retcon. She was flying better than anyone a few years earlier. I suppose that this is supposed to bring some impact to Pan's arrival in the Peaceful World Saga, where she comes to Goku and tells him that she can fly now across the whole planet. I do hope that at least the characters acknowledge this in the future and at least offer a hypothetical answer as to why she can't fly anymore. Maybe she had a traumatic experience. Maybe she experienced something that shook her confidence. Maybe she has the same wussy nature that Gohan had at that age. Trunks' fear of ghosts also seemed to come out of left field as far as I can remember, but alas, it is nice to see Dragon Ball return. This will likely lead up to saying that it was Goten and Trunks who put Dr. Hedo in prison like we see him during the Dragon Ball Super Superhero movie. I also anticipate Broly's return to the series. I'm hoping that we can at least get a good fight with him in the manga that's actually shown. Like, we see him in Goku training, and suddenly he goes off like a bomb. First wrathful, then Super Saiyan, then Super Saiyan full power. It would be so fire. Now, moving on, I was reading through when I noticed a few things that GT fans would remember. The first thing I noticed would be during Trunks' trip to school. See that guy running the hot dog stand? Well, this isn't the first time we see him. His character model actually originated from GT, though it likely isn't the same person, as he exists after the 100-year time skip. But anyway, during Goku Jr.'s journey to Mount Paozu, there was a trucker who enjoyed fast food burgers and the like who stopped alongside the road to pick up Goku Jr. However, when the driver ran out of food and Goku Jr. stopped to take a leak, the truck driver emptied out all the food in his bag and then left him on the side of the road. So while this guy isn't really a big hint at anything, it is a nice nod to an obscure character from a single episode. Now, the GT thing was something I've been thinking about for a while. In the past, Toei released a large timeline of Dragon Ball that included GT after DBS, so that got me thinking about the possibility, though I hardly paid it much mind. But when I saw the Dragon Ball Super Superhero movie, I literally watched it for the lore. And a part of the lore that goes under the radar is the scene where Piccolo kidnaps Pan alongside the other Red Ribbon Army agent. Piccolo takes off and begins to fly, which he does rather badly, something Pan comments on. Piccolo responds by telling her that he failed to get his driver's license. This is in reference to a famous and beloved episode of Dragon Ball Z, where Goku and Piccolo both attempt to get their driver's licenses. Piccolo seems to have a little more finesse with his driving skills, but Goku's ability to drive is so horrendous that the DMV actually bans him from returning to get his license. He does later accomplish this after Chi-Chi Karens them into letting him try again. However, in that episode, Piccolo witnesses Goku's horrid driving and takes it as a challenge. Both of them drive so recklessly that it isn't even funny, which results in neither of them getting a license. This episode was referenced by Piccolo in the movie, but the funny thing is, this entire episode is what you might call filler. What this means is that it didn't happen in the manga, and as such isn't regarded as canon in the main series. Other ideas of such things would be Dragon Ball Z movies, such as the original Broly trilogy, though Cooler could be speculated to have been possible at least the original one, due to Cooler's appearance in GT, which, if canon, insinuates that this event is at least true. This isn't the first time that non-canon material made it into Toriyama's canon. The special Bardock, Father of Goku, was actually not even written by Toriyama, and instead was a completely Toei original special. However, Toriyama enjoyed it so much that you can actually see it added to the canon during the Frieza saga, in which Bardock and King Vegeta make their appearance wearing their Z-only gear. Later, Bardock's story is retconned, but he was canon originally prior to the events of Dragon Ball Minus and the Broly movie, which is a direct follow-up to Minus. Still, this isn't the only thing that makes me wonder. What really makes me wonder if GT is still considered canon by Toriyama is when Trunks was in school. While in school, Compass makes mention that Trunks is planned to inherit Capsule Corporation, becoming its new CEO. Trunks responds that he doesn't want to, though, because it's too boring and that he needs some action in his life. This is a direct reference to GT, in which we first see Trunks as the CEO of Capsule Corp, and he shows complete disinterest in the job as a whole, delegating everything he can to his secretary before sneaking out the window to go adventuring. This would be where Vegeta would find him and demand that he come with Goku and Pan on an adventure to the stars. GT could easily fit into the canon if only a few things get some explanation, such as the ages of Pilaf and the gang being well into their golden years. Some people might cite a lack of transformations as another possibility, but just because Ultra Instinct and Ultra Ego don't make an appearance in the series doesn't mean that they don't still exist. Gohan never once used Potential Unleashed in GT despite having it, and the form being stronger than Super Saiyan 2. And before we go any further, we can't forget that Goku actually did use Ultra Instinct in GT. While it might come as a surprise to you, Goku actually used it during his battle against Omega Shenron. After his eyes were blinded in his battle with Ice Shenron, Sin Shenron, who would later become Omega Shenron, would take advantage of this and attack him. After getting back to full power, Goku manages to not only fight on par with Omega while unable to see, but he also dodges all of his attacks with Ultra Instinct-like dexterity. And before you say it was merely him sensing ki, this was not the case, as Omega Shenron proved this much by throwing a clock face at him from behind, which Omega specifically mentioned possessed no ki for him to sense, and still Goku turned around just in time to grab it and slow it down. We also know from Dragon Ball Super's storyline that it is possible to use godlike strength without transforming into a divine form itself, so possibly Goku has been adding some godlike strength, which, while as strong as a divine form, does not possess the same inability to be sensed as the parent forms. Super Saiyan 4, in the Japanese script, is actually alluded to be a potential Unleash type form, with Old Kai mentioning that Super Saiyan 4 will draw out Goku's latent abilities and latent power. So imagine Gohan's potential unleashed transformation on top of godlike strength with Ultra Instinct's autonomous movements as the icing on the cake. Not only would he save stamina by not transforming into Blue, but he would be just as strong, if not stronger than Ultra Instinct in a more natural form. That arguably makes perfect use of Saiyan Instinct to adapt in battle as they fight, an ability that Vegeta claims cannot be present while using Ultra Instinct in its mastered form. And given Beerus' ability to use Ultra Ego without transforming as well, it's easily possible that these concepts are possible to be mixed into other forms. The sky's the limit with this. And while you may question this, it should be known that things that were further off the radar compared to GT have been added to the Dragon Ball canon as of late. While not having been written by Toriyama himself, most people fail to realize that he did still have a large hand in GT's creation, providing character designs for the series. Toriyama personally designed Giru, the robot companion picked up in their travels, as well as the spaceship that they would use. His view on GT is positive, and his involvement in it is about the same as it was for many of the movies. He stated further that GT is a grand side story to the original Dragon Ball storyline. Due to all of this, including Toei apparently believing that they are all a part of the same timeline, it is possible to conclude that GT is still canon to the main timeline, much like it had been prior to Dragon Ball Super's creation. Toriyama sure seems to think so, and considering that he brings non-canon things into official canon every day, I don't see why he wouldn't be willing to bring GT into the main canon too, but I suppose that's just my two cents. What do you think about it? Did you enjoy the newest chapter of Dragon Ball Super? What was the best part in your opinion? I won't lie, I was excited when the movie showed us that Goten and Trunks would finally grow up a little. Considering how fast future Trunks grew up in his own timeline, I began to wonder why Trunks and Goten weren't getting bigger in the main timeline, which had surpassed the Android Saga timeframe. While I am a little sad to see the adorable little mini Goku go, I am glad to see Goten maintaining his personality and making progress as a character, which up to this point he sorely lacked. I'm also glad that Goten and Trunks are getting an arc all to themselves that actually makes a difference to the story. Most of the time, they served as comedy relief or were only used for a short period of time to accomplish something that didn't work out anyway. It's nice to see them being remembered. Now, where's Yamcha's spin-off arc? Anyway, if you liked the video, be sure to click the thumbs up, and if you haven't subscribed, be sure to do that. It shows support for the channel and helps us keep making content like this. And if you want to be notified when more content like this drops, please ring the bell. Until we meet again, peace.